God is going to give you a trumpet to blow. To hold the trumpet, that is a holy vessel from heaven. The hand that holds that vessel must be clean. And God is going to give you a sword of the Spirit to wage war with the enemies of God. That sword is not just called a sword, it is called the sword of the Holy Spirit. It is not our sword, it is His sword. A sword forged in the light of heaven. You know, I once had the great privilege by the mercies of God to see how weapons in heaven are made. I was taken to this place where the weapons in heaven are made. So there were different kinds of weapons. We have only heard of the sword of the Spirit, but they are more than that. And I saw this angelic army that are involved in making those weapons. And they showed me what is the component they use to make that. So I was very fascinated. In the world, you use iron, metal to make those weapons. But in heaven, it is not. They use a different component. That's why it is different. So the vessel that you're going to hold in your hand, the sword, the hand that bears that vessel must be clean. Must be clean. Most importantly, you are carrying the Ark of the Covenant within you. So this vessel that bears the vessel of God within you must be clean. Must be holy. Must be pure. And most importantly, walk in humility. Before the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost, God gathered to Himself a small group in the upper room. Acts chapter 1 verse 12 says, after the Lord Jesus Christ was taken up to heaven, 500 people saw the Lord Jesus Christ. And 500 people heard His command to wait in Jerusalem until they receive the power on high. So after the Lord Jesus was taken up, everybody was still looking up until it's totally gone. Then when it was totally gone, reality now sets in. What do we do next? So when the reality set in, we read 120 of the 500 were in the upper room. So I always ask myself this question, what happened to the other 380? The 380 were enthralled by an experience. They were enthralled. They got excited because of an encounter. That's all they wanted. A visitation. But the 120 were not satisfied with the visitation. They continued further to convert the visitation into a habitation. This should be your goal. Don't just lust after a visitation. Seek a habitation. That the glory of God comes to abide within you and in you. Only then you will understand the complete secret of what Luke 17:21 says. The kingdom of God is within you. Not only that, in John chapter 17, the Lord Jesus Christ prayed a prayer like this. Father, as you are in me and I in you, I pray that they will be in me and I in them. Now, what is that prayer? What is that secret? And in John chapter 14, verse 23, it says, I and the Father will come and make our abode with you. See, not only the Lord Jesus Christ comes, even the Father God comes to make his abode with you. See, this is inhabitation. I want to encourage you tonight. Take this to your heart and make a decisive decision today. You will no more lust after a visitation, but you will work towards a habitation where you are not just abiding at the foothills of Mount Sinai, but you are abiding with the Lamb of God on Mount Zion. Mount Zion is your goal, not Mount Sinai. Mount Sinai is a place of visitation. The children of Israel were at the bottom of the mountain and they had a visitation, period. But on Mount Zion, it's different. If you read Revelation chapter 14 verse 1, it says, the 144,000 who had the seal of God on their foreheads were abiding together with the Lamb of God on Mount Zion. They were on top of Mount Zion together with the Lamb of God. Not like the children of Israel at the foothill. So this should be a pursuit. Pursue a habitation. Because God has desired to gather you to himself. He has desired, he has purposed to gather together things that are in heaven and things that are on the earth. So he gathered together a group. This 120 motley crew of seekers. Now there were some identifying marks, characteristic traits in them. What are they? Number one, they had no agenda. They had no other agenda. Number two, no one claimed to be a leader to boss around. Every one of them, 120, were all disciples. Acts chapter 1 verse 13 says like that. Even the apostle Peter, was the chief among all apostles. He did not boss anybody. He was just like one among everyone. Number three, everyone had a servant heart. And they all looked at each other as equals. Not one person is high, another person low. Everybody equal. Number four, Acts 1:14 says, they sought God with all their hearts. Not just wishy-washy prayer. Many Christians sadly pray like this. If the Lord wills, he can give me. If he doesn't will, it's okay. No, don't pray this wishy-washy prayer. Your pursuit must be, give me or I die. That should be your heart attitude. Give me, Lord, or I die. I will not leave this place until I have an encounter with you. You know, the many saints or the men and women of God who made great impact in the world, they had such an attitude in them. I'm not going to come out of that prayer closet until I have an encounter with you. One of the great prophets of God who God raised up in the US is William Branham. He had such a heart attitude. He told his wife, I'm going to seek God. Either I come out having met with him or I will die in the jungle. And he told his wife, don't come and look for me. And after 3 days, he came home. When he stepped into the house. William Branham's wife looked at his face and she said, "You have." So he asked her, "How do you know?" "The light on your face speaks louder than what you can tell me." There was a light all over his face. The great father of faith, the late Kenneth E. Hagin, before he had his spiritual eyes open and he walked in the revelational realm of God, he told his wife similarly like that. He wanted to seek God. So he told her, "I'm going to pray in the church. Don't bother to come and look for me. Don't bother to come and call me for meals. If I need to come, I will know when to come. I'm going to seek God, and I will only come when I have met with him." And he was locked in the church for days, for whole hours. He never ate food. Day and night. He cried and he prayed and he waited on God until the Lord came and blessed him. See, you must have that attitude. Not just wishy-washy attitude. Or not just seek God when you are free. See, this is another problem with modern Christians today. You want to seek God when you are free. You will come to a conference like this when you are free on the weekends. You're not willing to pay the price. Several years ago, the Lord called me to conduct a youth camp meeting in India. And he specifically gave me the dates when the camp meeting should be done. And to my horror, it was a weekday. So I told the Lord, "Lord, the dates that you gave me are weekdays. Who will come to the meeting?" But the Lord specifically said, "These are the dates. I want you to organize the meeting." So we announced the meeting. And about, initially, there were only about a few hundred registrations. Very small. Then, many people wrote me, "Say, why are you having a meeting on a weekday? If you have it on the weekends, we are free. We don't have work on that day, and we can all come freely. But if you have it on weekdays, we need to apply for vacation time. We need to apply for leaves. So please change those dates." I told them, "Please don't come. If you cannot pay a price, don't come. If you want a touch from God, it costs us a price, you know. It costs us a price. Before the prophet Moses was caught up to heaven and he was there in God's presence for 40 days and 40 nights, he paid the price to be all alone on Mount Sinai for 6 long days and 6 long nights. It was only on the 7th day that God spoke with him. Not the first 6 days. There was a price to pay. Not only that, there was another big price he paid. When he came from Midian towards Egypt, the Bible says he brought his wife and 2 sons together with him. And then, that is Exodus chapter 4. And then in chapter 18, you read that Moses' father-in-law, Jethro, comes to visit him. And the scripture says, Jethro brought with him Moses' wife and sons, whom he had sent back. So from chapter 4 to chapter 18, during that interval period, Moses had sent back his wife and sons to the father's house. Why? It was a price he had to pay to serve God. Not everyone is him. The call was put on him. See, he need to be in the presence of God for 40 days and 40 nights. The wife should not be calling him, honey, where are you? Honey, it's dinner time. He should not be distracted by all that. He has to take care of 3 million Israelites. See, there was a price he had to pay. And for the price he paid, the Lord covenanted with him that your sons will have an inheritance in the promised land. And when Joshua divided the promised land, he gave 2 portions to Moses' sons. See, that was God's covenant for the price that Moses was willing to pay. Today, many are not willing to pay prices. We want everything easy. Because of technology today, most people don't want to come to a conference. They'll sit in the comfort and watch on YouTube. Watch on live telecast. Which is okay if you're far away somewhere. But if you live in Gettysburg and you don't drive to come here, there's a price to pay. Price to pay. Have you heard of this proverb that says, the early bird catches the worm? See, the bird has to go out early in the morning to catch the worm, while all other birds are sleeping very comfortably under fleece blankets. This bird goes out early in the morning with the mist all over, with the cold all over, to catch the worm. So there is a price to pay. They sought God with all their hearts. Number 5. They waited patiently for God's time. Acts chapter 2 verse 1 says, when the day of Pentecost came, then the Holy Ghost was poured out. But prior to that, they were waiting in God's presence for 10 days. They did not know when the Holy Ghost is going to be poured out. All they knew was, the Lord Jesus said, wait in Jerusalem. So they waited patiently. So if God gives you a promise, even though months may have passed, years may have passed, and you are wondering when it will come to pass, wait patiently. Many people ask me this question, you know. Oh, God told me this, but it has not come to pass so far. Why? So I ask them this. I asked them a question. Did God truly speak to you in the first place? Many of them say, yes. If God truly speaks to you, then wait. How long? Very soon. How soon? So I tell them, according to biblical times, soon means, can mean 2,000 years. Because the Lord Jesus said, I'm coming soon. And 2,000 years have passed by, he still hasn't come back yet. So that's where I got the figure, soon can mean 2,000 years. Listen, everybody. God is God. You are flesh. You are the clay. The clay cannot tell the potter how the clay should be made. The potter has a design. The master has a time when to come or when to fulfill certain things in your life. Don't hurry. Don't rush him. The reason why it's getting prolonged or delayed in your life is because you are not ready. Simple reason. Simple answer. You're not ready. If you were ready, then he would have given you. Let me give you a simple illustration from nature. It takes about 10 months for it to be fully formed in the mother's womb. And we know that some babies are prematurely born at 7 months, at 6 months, at 8 months. Any baby that is prematurely born, they are kept in an incubator in the hospital. Am I right? The hospital doesn't release the baby because the time has not come. When the time comes, it will be given. So, if God truly speaks to you, it's not your own flesh, it's not your own imagination, that you know beyond all shadow of doubt that truly the Lord God of Israel has spoken to you, then wait. The maker knows when to bring the product out. Number 6, they prayed earnestly, seeking God's promise. Acts chapter 1, verse 4 to 5 and verse 8. The Lord Jesus said, wait for the promise of the Father. So they prayed, Lord, send the promise of the Father. Send the promise of the Father. They prayed the promise. So you should pray the promise. Don't just sit wishy-washing when things will come to pass. Take the promises of God and pray the promise. Lord, you promise. Therefore, I believe and I pray. Now, after they were baptized with the Holy Spirit, now what happens next? Another 6 things takes place. Number 1, no one sought to build an independent ministry. Peter, James, John, all these 12 apostles, disciples. Now that they all feel the Holy Spirit, I'm going to start Peter's Ministries International. James Ministries International. Big James, James the Less Ministry, James the Great Ministry. No one sought to build an independent ministry. Rather, it was a team ministry. We see this pattern in the church at Antioch. In Acts chapter 13 verse 1, all the prophets, all the teachers, all the pastors were together in one place in Antioch. Before they were all sent out in groups and as missionaries, they were all together in one place. Team ministry. No one person decided to go on their own. Number 2, no one sought to build an empire. They didn't want to do that. Build their own denomination, build their own empire. Have you heard of this kind of a marketing in the world called multi-level marketing? Okay, you are familiar with that term, right? Now, I introduce you to another new term. MLMM. MLM is multi-level marketing. But I introduce today to you MLMM. What is MLMM? Multi-level marketing ministries. Don't laugh. It's happening. Multi-level marketing ministry. They seek different ways to market themselves. And nobody. You hire marketing companies, brand companies to market you. Inflate you when you are nobody to make you look like somebody. You know, every day I get many, many resumes from many people who want to work in our ministry. So once I was conducting interview, so one young man came and I looked at his resume. It was so impressive. It was all full of 5 stars. But when I talked with him, there was not a single star. So I asked him, how is it that what is written in your resume is not what I see in person? So this young man He looked down on the ground for a while, thinking what to answer me. And then I coaxed him. I said, come on, tell me. If you want a job, tell me the truth. He said, oh, I just copied it from the internet. Oh, they are on the internet, they are ready-made resumes, you know. You can just copy-paste. See? Inflating up of oneself what you are really not. Who you are, you don't have to market yourselves. The gifts will speak for itself. Right? I always look at nature, you know. And one day I saw a dog. This dog was walking down the street. And I looked very closely at the dog. And I realized the dog did not have a name tag called dog. We all have name tags. See, if you see on the seats, after this meeting are dismissed, you come to the front row, you look at the chairs, you'll find our names on the chairs. So I'm only supposed to sit only on that chair. I'm not supposed to sit anywhere else. So this is that my allocated seat. So it has my name there, and they spelled my name wrongly. It's okay. And instead of a name tag on the chair, they have a name tag on the badges, you know. But when I look at the dog doesn't have a badge, dog. But how do I know dog? When it opens its barks. By his characteristics, by his calling, the dog's calling is to bark. When it barks, you'll know it's a dog. In the same manner. You don't have to advertise, you are a pastor, you are a prophet, you are an evangelist, you are a teacher. When you open your mouth, people will know who you are. Amen. You don't need to market. In the market, there are only fishes. Dead fishes, not alive. So, these apostles, they did not sought to build an empire. None of them sought multi-level marketing ministry. In fact, everywhere when they went, when a miracle took place, that miracle was advertised for them. And came flocking for their prayers and for their ministry as a result of the works of their ministry. Number three, no one merchandise the anointing that God gave them. We see this problem in the first century during the time of the Lord Jesus Christ. Matthew chapter 21 verse 12 tells us they were selling doves in the temple. Doves represents the anointing of the Holy Spirit. They were selling their gifts. They are merchandising their anointing. None of them did that. Number four. Instead, Acts chapter 5 verse 42, chapter 8 verse 4 verse 25, and chapter 13 verse 49 says, they merely preached the word. That's all. They preach the gospel of the kingdom. They preach the Lord Jesus. They preach the word. That's all they did. Number five. They did not cash on their ministry. Which means they did not turn their ministry into a business venture. Money-making venture. Rather, they trusted God for their support, which was a command the Lord Jesus had given to them in Matthew chapter 10, verses 9 to 10. The Lord said, to whichever village you go, stay in the house of a prominent person and they will feed you. Because a laborer is worthy of his labor. You don't set a fee. You're speaking fee. I was once invited by a church in Tulsa, Oklahoma. So they sent me their letter. And they said, we would like to invite you to come and speak at our church conference for 3 days. And you will speak 3 sessions. And we will pay you $750 for each session. So I looked at the letter and I replied to the pastor. Pastor, I am not for sale. There are others who are for sale. You can invite them. Period. You don't set fee. You're not a politician like Obama, no? Who after you become a president and you retire, you can command $200,000 or $300,000 speaking fee. I tell you one truth. Why you cannot command that? The reason is because, let's say, a politician like the ex-president of the U.S. The ex-president of the U.S., when they go and speak at any university lecture or business lecture, they can demand a speaking fees. $200,000 or $75,000 or whichever amount, because of their years of experience, 4 years of managing a large nation like the U.S., the supposed superpower of the world. Not only one nation, but you have to deal with all the foreign affairs of the nations around the world. So you gain a ton of experience. Your knowledge increases. But a minister of God, you are not speaking your own words. You are speaking under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So the words that you speak are not yours. They come from God. It is the Holy One of Israel who inspires your thoughts to speak. It is He who brings all the scriptures to your mind so that you can quote them from Genesis to Revelation. It is He who gives you the names of the people when you begin to pray. It is He who gives you words of knowledge, words of wisdom. It is He who releases His gifts to work through you. So when you are just a conduit for the glory of God to pass through, how can you name a price? You cannot name a price. Because the words that you speak are not your words. So therefore, a man of God, a woman of God, have no right to claim a fee. That does not mean that pastors can say, okay, since you did not speak on your own, no money, no offering for you. That does not mean that either, because the scripture says a worker is worthy of his labor. You know, I pondered for a long time why many speakers demand a big fee. If not big fee, at least some fee. Why do they do that? I got an opportunity to talk with one minister who demanded not too big a fee, but a fee, which is quite big. So he told me of a very bad experience that he had. A certain church in a certain nation invited him. And when he left, they did not even pay for his hotel fee, hotel accommodation, or his transport. He ended up paying everything on his own. And not only that, they used his meeting to collect large offerings, many offerings for themselves. I personally had that encounter. In the year 1991, when I first came to the U.S., I was invited by one church in Grand Rapids, Michigan. So I got I hopped on the Greyhound bus from Cincinnati, went on a several hours journey to Grand Rapids, Michigan. It's a house church gathering.